We are preparing our hearts for communion. I want to bring this thought to you. Luke chapter 2 verse 15. So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another. So it was when all the Christmas cake was over and the Christmas pudding and the burger had gone into devouring bellies and carols had become hushed. What do you do? So my thought this evening is, after glory fades away and angels had gone away, Jesus is still there. This Christmas, there was quite a bit of thoughts about blue Christmas. That is, people who particularly at this time feel their blues. You understand what blues? Children are abroad, they are alone here. Sometimes they are in elders' homes. And they remember when everyone was together. Children were young. And for them also, we can say Jesus is still there. We can say that Jesus is still there. Because the glory was so visible and the singing was so audible. Glory to God in the highest and in earth peace. Goodwill towards men. So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. When the glory went and the lights went off, they just looked at each other. They still had their dirty work clothes. They had worked long that night. And the sheep were still smelly. But, say with me, but, they had a revelation. And they remembered what the Lord has made known to us. Then they spoke to each other. So already a little church came around that night. The shepherds said to one another, say to your neighbor, one another. So Christianity is all about one another, particularly New Testament Christianity. So when visible glory dims, audible songs hush, we still have one another. Never be moved by state and screen in Christianity. Christianity is about one another. When the stage is off and we are not online, we still have one another. This is the emphasis of New Testament Christianity. One more time, one another. So just turn to your neighbor, maybe turn back or touch the one in front and say, we have one another. This is the strength of New Testament Christianity. Even without decor, thank God for this beautiful decor that has been there from 16th carol service. But even without all this, we have one another. So Christianity is every day, as Pastor Damayan said, 24/7, one another Christianity. So it's not about the star on the stage or star on the screen or star online. It's about one another. They spoke to one another. And you know, these shepherds are not theologically erudite in any sense. These were the shepherds that looked after the flocks of the temple. Those flocks belonged to the temple priests. And it was a massive business. And these sheep were for temple sacrifices. They were there at the gate of the temple. Jerusalem had how many gates? How many gates Jerusalem had? Take a guess. How many think Jerusalem had four gates? Eight gates? How many gates did Jerusalem have? 12 gates. And one gate was called sheep came. And what were sheep doing there? They were being sold. And then people come with 5 drachma and they have to let's say they come with 10 drachma, they have to give that to get the temple money. You can buy temple sheep only with temple money. Give me away if you're following me. And so to get a temple sheep, they have to give 10 drachma. That gives them 5 temple money. And that gives them a little lamb. So it was exorbitant business. This is what was happening at sheep gate. And what did Jesus do? Yeah. He came and whipped the tables. First time and the last time. Last time they said, if he continues, we will lose all our business. And they decided to kill him. And he died. So these were the same shepherds who looked after those sheep. And they never go to the synagogue. They are continually unclean because they are killing and handling dead sheep, and that's the business they were doing all the time. So they were not in any way theological, and they had a very bad reputation. But that one revelation, simply one revelation, turned their lives around. And it gave them worth. That tells us the gospel shines brightest when the darkness is greatest. Say with me, the gospel shines brightest when the darkness is greatest. This is where we want the gospel to be. We have had 8 carol meetings this year. This evening we were in Giono there, one other evening. And 26th will be our last carol time, I'm very sad, because these days don't stay, you know. I wish it was still 12th, but the days run. 26th we will be in Kharvata Junction. Police is giving us permission to go in our old truck and tell the gospel. This is the best time in Sri Lanka to tell the gospel. And as Pastor Naman said, gospel is all about others receiving Christ. So they said, let us now go to Bethlehem. Did you see that in your Bible? Maybe you can't read it. There's a particular Greek word they didn't want to delay. Delayed obedience is actually disobedience. So they said, let us now go to Bethlehem. They were religious people. They cursed all the time. They were not nice people. But one revelation of the glory of God had changed them forever. And if you're wondering, of all the people who were in Jerusalem, why did God give the first invite to these shepherds? There was a reason. He didn't want to miss Israel having the best chance, the first chance of receiving him. These shepherds kept telling everyone, kept telling the masters. Who were their masters? Who were the masters of the shepherds? The priests. High priests, every priest, they kept saying, he's the Messiah. We saw, he's the Messiah. And of all the witnesses, priests would know, these ignorant people, irreligious people, can't concoct the story. So even when he came the first time, he wanted to give Israel best chance, saving the best chance. I want to appeal to you tonight, beseech you, give the best chance to your relatives, neighbors, office mates, friends, even those whom you meet, happenstance. Give the best chance for them to hear Christ. Will you say with me, Lord Jesus, help me to give the best chance. He didn't forget the chosen race, even in the first advent. And when the second advent is nearing, he's not going to forget his chosen race also. But there would be a great, great struggle. Let us go now to Bethlehem. Now, will you say, we now see this thing that has come to pass. They believe immediately it has already happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So when the glory fades and the angels go, yet the word of the Lord remains, it never fades. Will you say me one more time? Word of the Lord ever remains, never fades. That is 1 Peter 1:23. And they came with haste. Second time it says haste, quickly, haste. and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger, and it was a miserable night. It was a miserable night, and Mary was thinking, all the glory I felt when Gabriel spoke, I agreed to this, and long way we had come. And here we are in a dungyard with straw, cattle, animal, no privacy, nothing at all. And glory born. The shepherds come just in time. These shepherds who never knew any theology, they come and encourage Joseph and Mary. When they had seen him, Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now, see, the vision was so glorious, so visible, so audible, but when they come to see the real thing, say with me, the real thing, he was a baby in bandages, old clothes, probably the best robe carpenter Joseph had, but torn into pieces to wrap the child, to keep the child warm. It was chilly night, keep the child warm. But shepherds never wavered. They didn't say, how can this be the son? Everybody says, he'll come in glory. Good thing was, they had no prejudice. They were irreligious, utterly uneducated. They did not know how the Messiah should come. So they believed what the angels said, and they came and saw no glory. But they said, they were the angels. They were, we heard from God direct. Here is the baby. You remember the sign? Wrapped in swaddling cloth and laid in a manger. It was their manger. It's the same trough their sheep and their cattle ate from. So when the angels manifested to the shepherds and said, he will be laid in the manger, they didn't go to every manger in Bethlehem. Bethlehem was shepherd country everywhere. We know that from David's time, isn't it? It's the same place that David looked after sheep. Bethlehem had the best wheat. Bethlehem had the best grass. Bethlehem had the best sheep. Bethlehem had the best flax and a linen industry, which needed the best carpenters. That was Bethlehem. In its heyday, Bethlehem also had the best water. How do you know that? Bethlehem had the best water. How do you know that? You will get a piece of chocolate cake and a good coffee if you tell me that. How do you know that Bethlehem had good water? Quickly. Because David said, while in the cave of Adullam, oh, for some water from the well of Bethlehem. You remember that? And three men risked their life to get water from David. And David, when the water came, he said, typical of David, what did he say? These men risked their life for the water. This water belongs to the Lord. And he poured it as a libation to the Lord. That's Bethlehem. Solomon beautified Bethlehem, and there were beautiful gardens from Bethlehem to Jerusalem, 2 kilometers. And Bethlehem was higher than Jerusalem. So water from Bethlehem was tracked to Jerusalem through canals. This is that Bethlehem. But that night, it had faded out from its former glory, and the shepherds came and stole it. Shivering Mary and bewildered Joseph, shepherds came and said, look, we saw the glory of this child in heaven. Mary, Joseph, don't be feeble-hearted. Don't be faint-hearted. Though it looks so bleak, he's the Son of the Most High. He's the glorious one. Angels told us. And Mary took courage, and Joseph took faith once again. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. One marvel was Shepherds were preaching the gospel. Now turn to your neighbor and say, tomorrow morning, there's going to be a marvel. I'm going to talk the gospel. And people are going to hear it. They'll turn to Christ. They're going to be a marvel. I'm going to tell the gospel. One marvel was that shepherds were telling the gospel. If you have thought of yourself as, I'm not the kind to talk, I'm shy, I don't know much to say, I don't know what to say, this marvel is going to happen. You are going to speak the gospel. If shepherds can speak with no education, with such good education, you will be able to. All those who heard it marveled at these things which were told them by the shepherd. Other reason was they were marveling. Did God come in this glorious fashion? They were marveling also. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Let's get ready for communion in this context. I saw a vision when I was preparing for this season. There was a flock, and this flock was a lot of sheep. They were doing the sheep thing, chewing their grass and minding their business. What is the business of the sheep? Chewing grass, eating good grass where the good shepherd leads, and producing good wool, producing little fellows, and looking after lambs, and offering their wool, offering their wool to the shearers without a word. Did you understand sheep business? That's what sheep did. They minded their business. They did what they were called to do. They grew, they ate their grass, they grew their wool, and they looked after their little fellows. While this flock was going on, there was another scene. Running races. Say it be running races. There were some goats running races. And it looked as if they were doing the more colorful thing, dramatic thing, the more visible thing, the goats running races. But the sheep were doing the dull thing, doing what God had called them to do. And at a certain time came a trumpet blast, and it was time for the great shepherd to return. And he became visible. At the trumpet blast, the goats were alarmed. Who is disturbing us? They did not know the great shepherd had a time. Time had come for the last trumpet to sound, and the goats fell back, and the sheep were also taken aback. But this is the one they waited for. And a sudden change came. His garments took the form of blood red, like in Isaiah 60. Blood red, like in Revelation chapter 19. Then another thing happened. To this blood red garment was added the hue of burning brass. And as he was coming down, the sheep took the color. It was evident that the master was wearing the woolen that every sheep gave him. Out of that, the garment was made, but now the garment had become blood red, and it took the mixed with the color of burning bronze. And then the sheep took the same color of the returning great shepherd, and in the twinkling of an eye, according to 1 Corinthians 15:52, in the twinkling of an eye, they were taken up to be with the Lord forever. So let's prepare our heart that we will give our hearts to Jesus. After this song, we will take the cup of communion and the broken bread, the symbol of life. Thank you. Corinthians chapter 11. Let's thank the Lord for a year of protection. That every Sunday we were able to gather. Let's thank God in Sri Lanka we have complete freedom of worship. And we also can evangelize quite freely. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23, for I received from the Lord that which I have delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take it, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. We want everyone to partake of the body and the symbol of the blood. Communion cup is not to keep you away, but to offer, give me an opportunity to do it right. Idea is not to keep out of it, but to get right. Bring your diseases to him. We believe when you take the bread and drink the symbol of the blood, that he heals our bodies. By his stripes we are healed. Divine healing is the children's bread. So get ready for divine healing. Get ready for cleansing. Get ready for sanctification. Get ready for addictions to be broken. Get ready for debt to be removed. Will you say amen for that? Let's prepare with great gladness as we remember his first coming with thanksgiving and look forward to his second coming in anticipation. In between he instituted the communion, that we may do this one another together. This is New Testament Christianity, and particularly with a grateful heart for all his provision. I want to thank the Lord for all his provision for the church to do what it does. And I want to bless God for you for being so faithful. Many of you giving much of tithes while being very faithful with tithes. Because of this, we can look after 70 plus congregations and orphanages, publish so much literature, reach out at different points. I say thank you to you and bless the Lord. It's the best thing to serve the Lord. Please come and receive that bread which is broken for you, and that cup of the New Testament, which is commemoration and celebration of what has happened, what we have heard. Father, we bless your congregation. Lift up your countenance over them. Protect their home, protect their children, protect their grandchildren, protect their marriages, Lord. Protect their income, protect them when they travel, protect them when they sleep. That your God who slumbers not. We cast ourselves entirely to your unfailing protection and your abundant providence, in Jesus' name.